Good morning. My name is Chris Ndikumana. I'm the host of the Kanguka broadcast. You're about to listen to today's broadcast translated from Kirundi to English. Be blessed.
Today's Tuesday. I'm delighted to be able to share God's word with you this morning. The word of God that we give you is a weapon that will accompany you throughout the day. I want to share this word with those who are afraid. You're facing some situation to the point where you feel discouraged and powerless. You might find yourself in a difficult situation, but you know who to contact to resolve it. There is someone who will help you, perhaps a friend, an acquaintance, or a colleague. In other words, you still see a way out. You see how to find the solution. You know how you're going to handle the situation, even if it scares you. For instance, if you need money, you know where you can borrow it. If it's a legal issue, you know you'll seek a lawyer. In short, you know where to turn. But today, I want to encourage someone who is in a situation with no way out, who doesn't know where to turn, and feels discouraged. It's a situation where neither your family, nor your friends, nor money, nor acquaintances can help you. For some listeners, it concerns your personal life. For others, it's about someone you know, and you don't know how to help. You might reach a point where you feel so tired, really, really tired, and you just want to be left alone. You don't want to have to explain your situation over and over to everyone who asks, because it's distressing and it hurts to keep repeating the same story when there's no solution. Sometimes, a person can be in such a difficult situation that they can't even cry or scream because they're so overwhelmed. If what I'm saying describes you, if you're filled with fear because of some issue, I want you to know that this word is for you. It's found in Exodus chapter 14 verse 13 and 14. It says, "And Moses said to the people, 'Do not be afraid. Stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace.'" Here, Moses had led God's people out of Egypt, and they had arrived at the Red Sea. They couldn't cross, and behind them, Pharaoh was pursuing them. Verse 13 says, "Do not be afraid." That's the first thing. The second thing is, stand still. The third thing is, see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. You may have tried many paths in your life. You may have asked how you should handle your situation. God's word is telling you today, do not be afraid. The reason we can miss God's deliverance is that we are so busy trying to find a solution ourselves. We pray, yes, but we still try to handle things on our own, with our own strength and intelligence, without involving God. It's not wrong to try to find a solution yourself. But when you see that there's nothing more you can do, let God take over. When God's people faced the Red Sea, they didn't know what to do. There were small children, women, and elderly men, and they couldn't cross. Verse 14 says, "The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace." You need to understand that when God's people were about to face another nation, sometimes God would tell them, "I will be with you, go and fight, and I will give you victory." But here, he told Moses, "I will fight for you," which is different from, "I will be with you in the fight." Here, God says he will fight for you. In other words, I want every listener to know that this is not your battle, it's God's battle. Leave it to him and hold your peace. Don't keep lamenting, don't keep being bitter because what you're seeking is delayed. Don't keep telling everyone what's happening to you, but hold your peace. When God's people obeyed, God opened the Red Sea, and they crossed. God wants to simplify things for you today. He wants to give you rest. Trust him, keep your faith in him, and let him work in the supernatural, in what is incomprehensible, in everything you saw as impossible, and just hold your peace. We're now in the second part of the broadcast and we're going to continue our study of the letter of Paul to the Colossians. Yesterday, we were still on the third chapter and I spoke about verses 18 to 20. Just as Paul did with the Ephesians, he addresses households, he's speaking to husbands, wives, children, fathers, and servants. He talks generally about how to behave within households and society. In verse 18, he speaks to wives. As I mentioned, he tells wives to be submissive to their husbands, just as he did with the Ephesians. The verse says, "Wives, submit to your own husbands, as is fitting in the Lord." This is what we need to understand. When a woman submits to her husband, it's a biblical principle. There are always debates on this topic. Some people argue that you cannot submit to someone who is not more intelligent or wealthier than you. But it's a matter of principle. It's a divine principle, as I've said. Even if you are richer than your husband, even if you are more intelligent and have more degrees than your husband, biblically speaking, spiritually speaking, you are supposed to submit to your husband. By submitting to your husband, you are submitting to his master, who is Christ. Paul shows us the order God has established. He speaks of God the Father, Christ, the husband, and the wife. The wife submits to her husband by submitting to Christ, who is the head. So, the husband is the head of the wife, and Christ is the head of the men, and God the Father is the head of Christ. This is the order Paul gave when addressing the Corinthians. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 3, Paul says, "But I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ, the head of woman is man, and the head of Christ is God." We see clearly here that he establishes a precise order. So there shouldn't be any debate about this, but there is a lot of debate. However, I stick to the Word of God. Those who have the Holy Spirit understand that what I'm saying aligns with the Word of God. So, in Colossians chapter 3 verse 18, we see that Paul asks wives to submit to their husbands, but this submission must be in accordance with the Word of God. If your husband leads you into sin, you should not submit to sin. You should not submit to or obey anything that is contrary to the Word of God. If he leads you into sin, that is not the submission I am talking about. I'm talking about submission in everything that is not contrary to the Word of God. In verse 19, he now speaks to husbands and he asks them to love their wives. Why does he not ask wives to love their husbands? Because it is natural for a woman to love her husband. So he asks husbands to love their wives. Here, the love he speaks of isn't about emotions, it's about actions. In other letters, he compares the husband to Christ who protects his church. So, the husband must love in the sense of protecting his wife, just as Christ protected the church. But here, he adds, do not be bitter toward them. This means you should not create frustrations or bitterness toward your wife. If a wife is filled with bitterness and frustration, she won't be able to submit joyfully, and there will be a negative atmosphere. That's why he says, do not be bitter toward them. Verse 20 speaks to the children. It says, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing to the Lord. I know there are children listening to Kanguka. I want the children listening to understand that when you resist your parents, you are resisting God. I'll repeat that. When you resist your father or your mother, you are resisting God. And when you obey your father or your mother, you are obeying God. The Lord is pleased when you obey your parents. So, when you resist your father or mother, you need to know that God is not pleased. The Lord is not happy when you resist your parents because it is rebellion. So, if you truly want to please God, you must obey your parents. Verse 21 says, fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. So, do not provoke your children. It's good to discipline your children when they do something wrong. I know that in the West, in Europe, in America, parents are now prohibited from punishing their children, but it's biblical for a parent to discipline their child. However, when you punish them, the children must see love, there must be love. Because if you don't show them love, the child will never know that you love them. When you finish disciplining a child, you must talk to them, converse with them, and make sure the child sees that there is love. You punish them because you love them. Verse 22 talks about servants. Those of you who work should do so not to please men, not just when their eyes are on you, as men pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing God. If you work, don't try to impress your bosses or your leaders, but work wholeheartedly to impress God. We often try to impress men, but you should impress God because it's God who gives promotion. This is well explained in verse 23, and whatever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and not to men. This is a sign of maturity. If it's the will of I am, we will continue tomorrow. Be blessed, everyone. If you're blessed or transformed by Kanguka teachings, you can send us a WhatsApp audio on +256781377337.